Ladies, let's talk about cervical mucus. Gentlemen, avert your eyes, cover your ears, don't listen. I'm just kidding. Stay right there, guys, because we're going to talk about all the things you can do to increase your cervical mucus. We're going to talk about 5 things you can do and 3 things you should not do. Don't do those things. Stay with me. Welcome back to Fertility Mom. If you haven't subscribed to my channel yet, be sure you hit that subscribe button and the bell so you know when I give you new stuff every week. I give you lots of science-based tips, tricks, and secrets to help you get pregnant naturally. And also, do me a favor, hit that like button underneath this video if you want to see more things like it. I could do part 2, part 3, part 4, all about cervical mucus because there's so much content. And while you're hitting that thumbs up, I'm going to give you a brief, really quick summary overview of what cervical mucus is. Okay, ladies, so cervical mucus is, that's just the good stuff. It's the holy grail of what you want to see when you're trying to get pregnant. And what you actually want to see is egg white cervical mucus, or what you'll see written or referred to as EWCM. Now, we want to see this for a variety of different reasons. Number one being that it's like a highway for your sperm, meaning that it actually makes the trip from your cervix all the way up to your fallopian tubes to meet your eggs. Makes it a lot easier for the sperm to do. The sperm have a lot of length, a lot of distance to travel there for these little itty bitty guys, and this cervical mucus provides the highway for them to get there. In addition, it's also more alkaline than your normal vaginal tract is. Normal vaginal tract is acidic, and that's for a variety of different reasons, and that's because you want to keep all the bad stuff out. Now, up until your fertile window, sperm and semen, those are all things that your cervix frowns upon. Those are all bad things. She doesn't want to see those until your fertile window is approaching. So she's going to keep an acidic environment down there to keep everything at bay. And that's just to keep, it's just to keep your flora and your cervix and your vagina, all that stuff safe. Now, when you hit your fertile window, your cervical mucus changes to become more alkaline, which matches the seminal fluid that the sperm are in. So it's the highway, it provides a more alkaline environment so they can stay alive, and it provides a lot of nutrients so that the sperm can actually stay alive and nourished for 5, 6, even 7 days in some women. Sperm can stay in your fallopian tube, chilling out, eating a little bit, and just waiting for that egg to drop. So cervical mucus is super, super important. If you don't have it, you have a lot of hormonal issues, and you're gonna have some fertility issues with that as well. Now, remember, estrogen is the main hormone that drives the change in your cervical mucus, meaning that as your estrogen rises throughout the first half of your cycle, that your cervical mucus is changing along with it. So you're gonna have your period, then you're gonna have a couple of dry days, and then you're gonna move into having sticky or tacky cervical mucus, onto lotiony cervical mucus, and then you're gonna get into your fertile cervical mucus, which is watery, and then you can have your egg white cervical mucus. So some women only have watery cervical mucus, and that is still considered fertile. Now, egg white cervical mucus is considered the best, the holy grail of cervical mucus, because it's much more nutrient dense for the sperm. That being said, you can get pregnant with watery. And some women don't even know if they have egg white cervical mucus. They may not see it. They may only see a little touch of it on a tissue after having a bowel movement. So there's a lot of gray area on when you see it, how much you see it, and it changes from woman to woman. But just know, watery and egg white are both considered fertile cervical, fertile. That should be a new word, fertile. Fertile cervical mucus. Woo! I was a brain baby. Okay, let's get into things that actually increase your cervical mucus. Number one, stay hydrated. You must make sure you are drinking enough water to actually have cervical mucus that is on the fertile end, because cervical mucus is made mostly of water. But I have a caveat to this that I am sure you have not heard from anybody else. You must make sure that your sodium chloride, i.e. salt, is in the proper range as well. Let me explain. Lots of people are told, hydrate, drink lots of water. If you want to have fertile cervical mucus, you just need to drink more water. Drink all the water. Yes, you need to stay hydrated, but if you drink too much water, what you end up doing is dehydrating your cells. Let me explain. you're taking in all of this water, you're taking in much, like much more water than your body's used to, you actually dilute your electrolytes. And in order for your body to become homeostatic again, because it doesn't like to have its electrolyte levels fooled around with, it's always gonna try and bring your electrolyte levels into homeostasis, where it likes to live. It likes all of its potassium and magnesium and its calcium. It likes all of those electrolytes to be in certain levels. So if you're drinking a lot of water and you're diluting them, your body is gonna do everything it can to bring those levels back to normal. Now, when your kidneys filtrate out this extra water, we know, fundamentally, water will follow salt. The only way that your body can get rid of this extra water is to actually kick out salt as well. So if you're drinking a lot of water, you're peeing a lot, you're actually excreting a lot of salt. And salt is actually really important in the amount of water that's in your cervical mucus. So if you're drinking a lot of water and you're still feeling thirsty, this is a big, big, big clue that your electrolytes are still off and you need to make sure that you're taking in enough salt. So make sure you're salting your foods and also make sure you're not drinking too much water. There is a too much. You wanna make sure you're drinking at least 80 ounces. If you usually drink more than that because you exercise a lot, follow your thirst cues, but do make sure that you are taking in the proper amount of salt. Salt on breakfast, salt on lunch, salt on dinner, maybe a little salt in your water if you want to. Thing number two you can do to increase cervical mucus is drink green tea. Now, there's no studies specifically about drinking green tea and increasing cervical mucus, but there are studies that have shown that women who drank green tea got pregnant more often than those who did not. And this could be for a variety of different reasons, but I'm only going to name two here. Number one is that green tea has a high amount of polyphenols, which are a powerful antioxidant. And if you have watched anything I have put out in any of my other videos, you know I'm a big proponent of decreasing inflammation because that helps restore a lot of health in the cells and just it's good overall for the body. So polyphenols is a powerful antioxidant. It also has something called hypoxanthine, which is found to be important in the follicular fluid of the egg itself. So it's important in egg maturation. In terms of specifically increasing cervical mucus, obviously I said there's no studies on that, but I can tell you from personal experience, I believe it did help me, and I know I've spoken to many women that claim it helped them. As far as adding green tea to your regimen, you should be drinking one glass of green tea or two if you're not drinking any other caffeinated beverages. If you're a coffee drinker, you should be drinking no more than 2 cups of coffee a day anyways. But if you are a coffee drinker, you should replace one of those cups with green tea. So 1 cup of coffee, 1 cup of green tea. If you're a tea drinker anyways, just drink 2 glasses of green tea and you're gonna drink it in your follicular phase all the way leading up to ovulation. And then after that, you can stop drinking it if you'd like to. Number three thing that you can do to help increase cervical mucus is grapefruits. And yes, I am so sure that you have heard grapefruit juice and grapefruits can help increase your cervical mucus that you might right now be deciding whether you should drink 7 gallons of grapefruit juice or just eat 5 whole ones in the morning. Much like the pineapple with implantation thing, there is actually zero research that has shown grapefruit juice or grapefruits increase cervical mucus. But there may be something to this. So, the liver is the thing that's responsible for breaking down estrogen in the body. And there is an element in grapefruits called furanocoumarins that have the ability to actually stop the liver's enzymes from breaking down estrogen for a period of several hours. So the theory behind this is that if you're drinking grapefruit juice or if you're eating grapefruits, you're actually decreasing the enzymatic metabolization of estrogen in the liver, thereby increasing estrogen and making your cervical mucus better. That could be a reason, but I also think that there's something to the fact that grapefruit and grapefruit juice actually helps with insulin resistance and glucose control. There have been tons of studies on this. Lots of studies in diabetics have shown that grapefruit juice actually helps to increase insulin sensitivity, which means decreased insulin resistance, and it decreases glucose levels. So all of that turns into decreased inflammation. So while there's no studies that show grapefruit juice can actually directly impact your cervical mucus, it can indirectly do it through these other ways. In terms of eating or drinking grapefruit juice, again, if you've watched any of my videos, you know I'm not a big proponent of doing anything that can impact on the cellular level inflammation. Eating a bunch of fruit in the morning or eating just juice without the fiber can increase your blood glucose overall. So What I would suggest is you have a half of a grapefruit with a small handful of nuts as an afternoon snack for maybe like 4 days up to and including the day of ovulation, and then you can just stop doing that, or you can continue if you really like it. But I'm not really a big fan of grapefruit. The fourth thing you can do to help increase cervical mucus is eat fatty fish and seafood. I talk about fatty fish and seafood in every single video, so definitely go watch some of those to learn more about the great things that fish can do for your body. But I'll briefly mention here, fatty fish can regulate your hormones, it can decrease inflammation, and it actually helps increase blood flow. All great things that we want to see for increasing cervical mucus. Okay, number five, you're gonna wanna take a probiotic. And this is because the flora in your gut closely resembles the flora in your vaginal tract. If you have a gut flora that is overrun by yeast and other bad bacteria, then so is your vaginal tract. And if you have yeast, your cervical mucus is gonna be no bueno. So, if you're taking a really good quality probiotic, you're repopulating your gut with really good bacteria that keep all the bad bacteria in check. This helps keep your pH rebalanced and aligned. It helps keep your body in good favor in all areas of your body. It helps boost your immune system, decrease inflammation. It does a ton of things. A probiotic is an absolute must add for your fertility regimen. I mentioned probiotics in all of my other videos too, so definitely make sure you're taking this. And if you're sitting there thinking, but I don't have a problem with yeast, or I don't have symptoms of bacterial vaginosis, that may be true, but you still might be having an issue with it. Some people have yeast and bacterial vaginosis. It's kind of like a background player. You don't really know it's there. You're not really experiencing any big symptoms of it, but it's still impacting your fertility. Taking a probiotic just helps decrease the likelihood that that is a problem for you. Okay, that was five things you can do to help increase your cervical mucus. I'm gonna give you three things that you should stop doing or not do. Number one is drinking lots of caffeine or alcohol. Yes, I said drink green tea. I didn't say drink a ton of green tea. If you're drinking a lot of caffeine or alcohol, your liver is prioritizing that stuff and it's not prioritizing regulating your hormones. Hormone regulation is one of the key elements of having good cervical mucus. So you wanna make sure that you're not loading your body up with stuff that your liver has to concentrate on, and you want your liver to concentrate on regulating hormones. Decrease caffeine, don't drink alcohol. Number two thing that you should stop doing immediately is douching. Your vagina is perfectly capable on its own of regulating its flora and pH, and when you introduce douching into the mix, you're actually getting in the way of your body's own regulation, and you're mixing things in there that shouldn't be in there. So just don't do it. Stop it. Just stop the douching. Number three thing you should not do is take over-the-counter cough medications. I know you have heard of this one. You may even be doing this yourself in an effort to increase your cervical mucus watery quality. The theory is here that it thins secretions in your lungs and in your nostrils, so it must thin secretions everywhere else, and that may be true. But cervical mucus is more about what's in it, and that's what causes the quality to be watery or egg white. So you can't just thin it out and hope that it's gonna be the kind of quality that you need to actually nourish the sperm and get them to where they need to go. If your cervical mucus is not naturally the quality that you need it to be, adding on an over-the-counter drug is not going to help your body achieve this. It may thin out the secretions, but it's not actually taking care of the root cause of the problem. You know me, you know I'm all about getting to the root cause, because that is the thing that's actually gonna make the biggest difference in your trying to conceive efforts. Don't take Robitussin, don't be taking Mucinex. It doesn't really help you in what you want to get done. It may thin the mucus, but the mucus is not gonna have the nutrient-dense value that it needs to, because it was never gonna be the quality that it was supposed to be to get the sperm where it needs to go. Okay, so now you know five things you can do to help increase your cervical mucus and three things you should not do. Don't do those three things. Don't do them. If you're doing them, then stop it right now. And if you stop those things, you will actually be helping your body to increase fertile cervical mucus as well. So those things are great to know. Do me a favor, hit the thumbs up button, hit me with a comment below, subscribe, hit the bell. Let me know if you really liked this video, because I can have a part two, a part three, a part four. I could go on forever about this stuff because it's so important. There's so many things you can do. I also have some information on my website. If you hit the links down below, you can get on my email list and get the five-step fertility boosting guide that I have there. It's for free and a lot of women are loving it, and you'll get on my email list so you'll get some information about new programs that I have coming out. Thanks for joining me on this episode of Fertility Mom. Make sure you comment, subscribe, and stay tuned for more great information from this channel. Talk to you later. Bye.